I'm back.
That was me. I just dialed back in. Let me get me in.
So you're calling me on one phone and you're in the combo in another, huh? Pretty exciting stuff on. I don't know. I'm going to call in.
Oh my God.
Wait, I can't hit mute. Okay, call in. Bye. Okay. That was exciting. Hey there, Anonymous. Can you talk to us?
I just did.
Say that again.
It's Florida One. I just did.
Oh, shit.
What's wrong?
Does Anonymous have anything to say worth of relevance here?
What's that noise? FFS, dude.
Hello?
No, it's all that background noise. I'm like someone's frying it or something. It's like, holy cow.
Did Anonymous hang up?
No, hold on, guys. Just hold on. Okay, there's one gone. And it's back. Okay, everybody. Brian?
Yeah, yeah.
You see?
Yeah. Wait a minute.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Yeah.
That one's not even... What the...
Okay, if you're a regular caller... If you're a regular caller, I want you to please hang up now and give us 5 minutes.
Is everything okay?
Just please hang up now and give us 5 minutes.
Okay, all right, I'm hanging up.
If you're a regular caller, please hang up now. Miss Debbie, I need you to hang up your phone, honey. I know you sit it on mute. Hang up and give us 5 minutes, please. Three, 813, please hang up and give us 5 minutes.
Hey, it's November 28.
November 28, please hang up now and give us 5 minutes.
All right.
3482, please hang up and give us 5 minutes. 3482, please hang up and give us 5 minutes. 3006. Oh.
That's me.
Sorry. Miss Debbie. Miss Debbie, please hang up. I hate to do this, but I know she's not listening.
It's all right. Do what you gotta do.
Okay, if there's any other callers in the room, I want you to please speak up. I can see 5 callers in the room.
Well, that's me, moderator, you, moderator. The one we're watching, the phone that attaches to that, and then myself. So it's just us right now. And it's that person. But that comes up as anonymous, as a call. And then there's that eyeball.
The anonymous is me. It should be me.
So it is? Okay, you're right. My bad. You're right, okay. I'm looking in the wrong box. So it just leaves them, but they're... See, if they have the same access that we do right now, if there's no calls on here, they can't hear us. Because if you take away the phones, that's a moderator. That's a PC. That's a moderator console, just like... All right, I don't know. Well, can I do that? I can't do that.
Can you do that far one in the end?
I can.
Try it and see what happens. I just want the line to be secure for all the people calling in. Did you hit the red X?
Yeah.
See how long it takes for him to come back.
Yeah.
It's freaky, man.
That's awesome, though. I'm not even a little. All right, look at it like this. If it was the feds, the CIA, anything like that, they were in long ago, and we weren't doing anything wrong then, and we're definitely not doing anything wrong now. We're not even on the call with buggies and shit, so... It's kind of cool. I think they're kind of mucking with us right now, which they didn't do anything. If they wanted to mess with us, they could have started shut the conference off, shut the recording off. Nothing changed except for their press.
They came in with your email address.
I know. That's so cool. I'm okay right now. If they're not in now, they don't have access to... that's interesting. Well, looky here.
Hi there, Anonymous. You want to talk to us? Hi there, Anonymous. Would you like to talk to us?
All right. Well, if they don't, it's okay. Could be just a person. It could be also... whoever was messing with our capabilities here. Well, they weren't messing with us, so I'll say, if you're still out there, dude, we saw your message, okay? So if everything you just told us is the plan you're sticking to, I'm cool with that, man. Just you definitely freaked me and Barbie out there for a minute, and I'm cool if you're cool. We're cool if you're cool. We prefer you not use that mode again, please. That'd be cool so we don't have to change our OPSEC again. But obviously you know who we are, man. If you're on the good guy's side, keep watching out for us. Like you said, you just work. But, preferably you don't mess with any of the files or information here, dude. That'd be really cool. Wow.
Brian.
Oh, man. Yeah.
This is Charlotte from Ohio. I've got my number, *67. I don't know how it's showing up on your end.
Okay, so it's not you.
No. Oh, what? How is it showing up? Restricted?
No. Yeah, you're coming up anonymous, just as if a *67 was blocking you, which anybody can do. I don't mind if they do it. It's just to us, we can't differentiate any anonymous from another anonymous.
Well, I can undo mine so you see my number come up if you want to try to narrow it down.
Actually, if you don't mind, hon, I will not say your number out, but if you could come in, not call blocked, that would help me a little bit right now.
Okay, I'll be right back.
If they come back, I want to keep calling out those guys that come in anonymous. Obviously, Barbie, I know which one's yours, but if more of those show up.
What happened? This is Michigan
one. Dude, it got weird in here for a quick minute, man. I'll explain it here in a minute when everybody else chimes in.
Barbie's going to go get a soda real quick because
Barbie's
soaked.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to soak.
Go take a walk, Barbie. I know you need it because I'm kind of like a little freaked out too. Yeah, that was pretty cool. It was weird, but it was cool. I'll explain when we get back up to a couple more people that were planning on calling back in, man. Basically, you know, to explain, only Barbie and I have the actual control panel capabilities for this conference call, right? And then comms one only has the call-in administrative capabilities where there's no PC involved, no actual like password. It was just a special number to use to chime right in. So as far as myself, Barbie, and comms one, nobody has the capability to do what we just basically saw happening on this control panel. The easiest way to explain it is another host came on here basically. Oh, I'm getting a lot of feedback, man. Barbie, that's you. Butthead.
I opened my soda. I'm sorry.
But so both of us are watching the control panel, dude, and right at the same time when you both heard us go, what the fuck? The actual name Anonymous came up, but differently, and it's, what did it say? It says OPSEC, and then we are here.
Yeah.
That was the actual name that it changed the name of the console, dude. And both of us are like, did you see that? I'm like, yeah, I see that. You see that? And then right after that, the next one came in. There was another one that came in. It said, what the hell did it say? Something.
I saw
something,
five.
Something, you are secure. When we started talking about it, she's like, uh-oh, are we secure? And then the name changed. Another comp came in, and it changed, and it said, you are secure. Getting some feedback here, though.
That's called a secure link.
But they were changing their name as we're watching it, and I can't even do that.
That's from the burner app. That's from the burner app. They're going through this from number to number.
No, it was a – dude, you don't understand. You can call in, and if you probably, I guess you could change your caller ID probably from a burner phone or app. Yes, I get that. But the fact of the matter is they came here as a moderator of the console, dude. They didn't just come in as a call. They came in as a moderator, and then another one popped up and said, something, you are secure. And then three more popped up, like within, at least two more popped up that I saw within a matter of minutes. And, I could tell nothing was changing. They weren't. It didn't feel like they were here to muck up the conversation because there's a lot of buttons they should. They could have clicked. They could have deleted. They could have erased. They could have muted. They could have changed it to Q&A and blah 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 and closed the conference down. But they were just sitting here talking to us. They were talking to us, dude. When they were changing their names as we're asking questions to the answers of the things that we were saying, then it just got really weird. And I'm glad Barbie hit me up on Facebook and it's like, maybe we should just shut this down and think about what's going on. Yeah.
Number one comes the safety and the security of all the callers, period.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And the safety of your network too. I mean, they get into that network, they can pretty much do what they want for your side of it and they can actually, you know, sabotage the network. So that is definitely security issues. It's big when you're dealing with something like this.
Or it was actually not this guy's. Well, obviously it was anonymous. Just basically letting you know, hey, we know you're there.
No.
I can't really see that happening because, I mean, they risk really giving up their. I mean, you are set up to where you have a system, so they don't know that you can't retract that or retrace that or get back
I just went into the history while we were off that call. That's why we stopped for the first set of like
right.
5 minutes or I went into the call history in details. There's no trace of that just happening whatsoever.
Wow.
Yeah, there's no, it's none. I'm looking at all the data. There's no other host moderators, no other IP capability, at least that I can see via the capability of the trace on the software. There's nothing else. So they cleaned the desk, dude. Now that, I personally feel I'm not real. I'm tripped out about it because not only was that a little scary, it was also exciting and like almost at the same time, I gotta admit in some way I'm kind of flattered.
Right.
Right. Because they would take the time and energy to show. That's what you
do. Like my ribs are shaking right now, dude. It's weird. I can't explain it. I'm kind of like, it's weird. I can't explain it. It's like I'm about. Yeah, it's just weird right now. I don't know what that was. All I know is they didn't change anything. They didn't alter anything. All the data that I was just looking at earlier when talking to Barbie is still in the same place. As a matter of fact, I don't even think they went in this field to alter any data. But the coolest part, I think, of that conversation, dude, Barbie, I can't even explain how awkward that was. Watching the all right, just so you guys know, in that software, there's actually a little eyeball that pops up for each moderator. So I can see Barbie, there's a little eyeball there. And when there were five eyeballs in this room a minute ago, and the names were changing as we're asking the questions, and they were giving us the answers to the questions, that was just, they were communicating with us, man. But they were communicating as the moderator console. They didn't just call to say hi. This time
they couldn't track them. They went in and used your own system, so you can't track them.
Well, dude,
like talking to a Ouija board.
I thought it was cool. Like right off the bat, it was like I forget. It said anonymous, and then OPSEC, and then like we are here.
Can you spell that OPSEC again? Spell that. Spell OPSEC.
OPSEC. OPSEC.
Yeah.
Which is operational security, but when we were like. We don't know. There's no IP. So basically they knew, obviously they must have been on this call periodically because Barbie, both of us at the same time, I'm like, Barbie, do you see that? She's like, oh, my God. I'm like, yeah, do you see that? And she's like, I hope we're secure. Within, what was that, 10 seconds, the next one came in, and now there's, what, four eyeballs, and it said, you are secure. And then there was a really cool symbol at the end of it. I saw, actually, I don't even know what symbol that's even called. That symbol's not even on a keyboard. So you know how they talk in leet speak and hacker speak. I don't know what that meant, but there was a little symbol behind you are secure. So
next time I'm taking pictures.
That was so cool. But they're gone. There's no other ones now. It looks like regular callers. There is
one.
There are three anonymous callers on here. Let's try this. I'm going to do something. Hey, Barbie, mute yourself real quick and then mute yourself back in for me.
I'm right here.
I know. Yeah. Okay, that's you? All right.
Yeah.
So I see two more anonymous callers, right? Just for giggles, because I know just about, oh, there's another one. As I say that, I hate when that happens. All right, so I'm going to mute and unmute that anonymous caller. Can you identify yourself, please? Interesting. I'm going to mute and unmute another caller. Can you identify yourself, please?
Can you hear me?
Yeah,
yes,
okay, that I heard. All right, cool.
You guys hear me?
Yeah, we can. If you could do me a favor, we're just doing a little experiment here, sir. If you could press *6 on your phone, that'll mute your phone. I've got to differentiate all these different anonymous calls that are in here right now.
Yeah, this is Tango 800. I'll *6 out.
So, okay, go. I do want to hear from you, but we got to try this right now.
Thank you, Tango.
All right. Yeah, thanks, bro. All right, two more. I'm going to mute you and unmute you. And do you see how that one's a little bit different?
Yep.
Can you identify yourself, caller, that was just muted and unmuted?
Come on, Florida.
No, Florida, please.
I'm gonna mute this number, and I'm gonna unmute this number. If you could say something for us, please. That might be the one. And I'm gonna do it to this guy. Caller, if your phone was just unmuted, could you say something real quick? All right. Well, that experiment just failed. All right. Well, I don't know it right now, but as you can see, Barbara, the one with that name closest to the bottom is the one that stands out right now.
Okay. I look at the one, the fourth from the bottom.
Yeah. I'm sorry. You're right. But yeah. Well,
In the caller
name field, that one's the one standing out. Can't do anything about it. I just muted that one. But so yeah, there's been a little suspicious activity around here lately.
This only happens when you're here.
Are you guys okay?
Yeah. It was just, I can't really, other than what we've just said, I can't really explain what the hell just happened. There's no moderator calls like us right now, but there are a couple suspicious anonymous callers. I can't even explain. There's caller ID and then caller name, so they chose to use the name anonymous again this time. But they're not in as a host. But we did have a weird scramble just happen. There was at least four or five hosts that just popped in out of nowhere. And it started off with Anonymous OPSEC is the first one. And it said, I forgot what it said behind it, We Are Here. That was the first one. That's a long name, too. I mean, I use a pretty long one. But there is Anonymous OPSEC We Are Here. And I'm not making this up. Barbara, you saw it. I wish we could have taken a picture. You're right.
Okay, wait a minute. One of them is Florida One. Hold on. I bet you it's this.
Yeah, all the anonymouses were having some feedback, so I just muted them all.
Okay. Florida One, did I unmute you? Anonymous, can you please state something? Just say something to tell me you're not Florida One. Make a beep on your phone or something. Okay. Let's try this one.
Who knows, man?
Anonymous, did I unmute you? Are you Florida One? Can you make some kind of sound on your phone so that we can identify you? Okay.
That was coming from Mike's phone, that background noise.
Yeah, I saw.
My phone?
Anonymous,
yes.
Can you please identify yourself?
Tango 800.
Okay. Anonymous, can you please identify yourself?
This is 4-1.
Okay.
Don't forget Tango 1 to ask a question or something.
Well, that narrows it down to two on our control panel. So let's just leave them muted. As long as they're being cool, I'm going to be cool. As long as I don't see any more of those eyeballs up here. Because that got real strange really fast. What I'm impressed with is their genius ability to do what they did. Again, I'm not that bothered because they didn't change anything. But what was awesome is that you, Barbie?
No, sir. Florida One, could you please mute your mic?
I got him. But what was amazing and ingenious was that as rapidly as we started asking questions, is as rapidly as they were being answered, but they were answering by changing their names, which is genius. And it was cool. It was happening right in front. I can't even explain it.
Because
they
weren't using the IP, they weren't using the telephone.
It was cool. They're not back. Obviously, they saw that they freaked us out a little bit. They're probably just listening in now. I don't know. Nothing changed. They were there. It freaked us out. So we killed the call for a minute, tried to restart it, and it restarted just fine, and they're not there anymore. But I don't know.
Has anybody looked up OPSEC? Because there's like a few different sites on them. I mean, they're different sites. One says it's a stop the politicians, President Obama and others, from politically capitalizing on U.S. national security operations and secrets.
Holy fuck.
That's one. And, I mean, there's a bunch of them in here. There's, Operation Security. What is OPSEC? And, it says it comes from the Marine Corps originally.
No, that was the first one that said anonymous. It wasn't the same kind. It was definitely those kind of people, dude. And that's a lot. If you actually type in anonymous OPSEC, I think you'd get a lot closer to where you should be looking right now, bro. Type in anonymous space OPSEC, and then you'll get a better idea who that just was.
I don't want to know. Florida One would like to be unmuted. He muted his own mic.
Go ahead.
Can I go back to what I was? Never mind.
Huh.
Hey, can I go back to what I was talking about before when this all happened?
Yeah, please. Sorry. Go ahead. Yeah. Please.
Yeah, if you plan on, or you even thinking about doing that whole, you know, with American Spring thing, bringing weapons, it's not a good idea because Maryland is very bad with its laws. If you don't have one in their state, they'll harass you just by your license plate. So you're going to have to figure out a way to either do it by buses or something, which, you know, they wouldn't be able to search then because it's they can't look at your license. They're like, oh, this person's got a conceal. And then, you know what I mean?
Right.
Because you heard about that famous story. It was pretty famous anyways. Where that guy left his weapon at home. He was traveling through Maryland, and they harassed him just by his license plate.
Right, yeah, I did actually hear about that.
So it's not a good idea if you're going to be announcing this, which you obviously... This is going to be announced on, you know, social media. They're going to be watching, and they're just going to pull over random people if you do this. So unless they're traveling in packs of, like, 10 or 12 cars or something, and they all pull over at once, that's the only way you're going to protect these people, unless you have some other form of way to get them down there, like through a bus or something.
Right. Well, remember, dude, we're not the organizers of this. We just thought, you know, based on what just happened and how we helped out the best we could with the Bundy situation, that we felt somehow, you know, maybe we could utilize these tools to help assist a peaceful resolution. You're right. Based on what you're saying, a lot of that's totally out of our control, man. And we know people are heading there, hopefully to God, they don't come with guns. We just don't want them to get arrested. We don't want violence. But then at the same time, we can't stop these guys. These are, you know... You're talking about active duties, veterans. You're talking about regular everyday Joes. You're talking about militia members. And we can't tell them what to do, dude. We're just dudes on a conference call trying to piece everything together, you know? So,
well,
I mean,
if you do say, like, hey, let's see if we can get more people who will come down with weapons or whatever. And if you do that, then you figure out a way for them to come down there without them getting stopped randomly by the good old Maryland State Police, you know?
So what are you saying, don't come through Maryland?
I don't think there's not a way around it.
You can't get around it. You got to go through Maryland to get to Washington, D.C. from any side.
Can't you fly?
And it's, if they're going to do it, they should at least know about that so they can figure out a way to, I don't know, someone was talking the other night about getting together and you know, renting some kind of bus or something, and it's relatively inexpensive, you know, if you have enough people and they can carry all their shit there, you know? And that way it wouldn't be under any one particular person to be going back to a company. So they couldn't track that, you know what I mean?
Well, they could. I mean, whoever books the tour or books the tour, I mean, they could probably use false information, but most of the time, they have to ask for ID to book a tour on a tour bus, or to get, maybe it's a private charter, and they pay a little extra and they can remain anonymous. I mean, that's all said and well, but as far as Florida goes, we have 300 that are talking about going so far that signed up for it on our sites. And they were talking, you know, carpool in and stuff like that. And then somebody did bring up the bus situation, and now people are starting to check into that too. So it's a good idea.
I think the bus is much better because you can't be individually, like, selected out.
Right,
and
of course. In a group like that, right, of course.
And if you got a bus full of, you know, people that you don't want to fuck with, then you know what I mean?
Well, 300, you're talking about the minimum of three buses right there with 96 people on to fit in on one of the regular buses.
You know, I'm just throwing this out there, but it would probably be a good idea. This came up before. Obviously, Maryland's got issues, right? So you've got the Virginia border. It's the southwest. There's
Virginia's
two main bridges,
right?
Well, right. What I think we need to do is probably rally point something like Arlington National Cemetery, which is right on the other side of the river, also in Virginia, and also a well-known location, really good for veterans, where it might be safe there, and have a majority of the people there. Now, if you look at the big picture, you're literally only a few miles away from D.C., but you're on the other side of the border in a safer area, such as, again, the Arlington National Cemetery, the Robert E. Lee Memorial. You've got the Marine Corps War Memorial. If they want to screw around with Marines at the Marine Corps War Memorial, you think veterans showed up a lot last winter? People would flip shit if they started it at the Marine Corps War Memorial at Arlington Cemetery. So looking at them, and there's four main ways to really kind of get in. There's actually, if I'm not mistaken, by the Lincoln Memorial, there's actually a way to walk in. Now, if you're on one side of the Arlington National Cemetery, you're actually in Virginia, it looks like, based on this map.
Yes.
Now, that's literally just a bit of a walk away and across the river right to the Lincoln Memorial, and, brother, you are literally right off of Constitution Avenue.
Right, of course. Yeah.
That's where last year everybody posted up when they wanted to do the march, D.C. march. They had the armed guys sit right where you're talking about, across by the memorial, and then everybody went and did their march, but they never needed to come in until they all went home. But, yeah, that's where you stage up with an arm.
So, you know, I'd say around that area of Virginia should be really rally point one, where they could get everybody on that side together, you know, at Arlington National, maybe say a prayer, you know, everybody go down the rundown about exactly how we want to do this peacefully and as possible, and then people that are coming in to walk them through, that way at least they're coming in, you know, in a somewhat controlled, you know, and I don't want to even be the advisor on that. I figure that's a good recommendation. But, you know, obviously there's Route 66 actually goes right through there, literally. So there's another way to get through. You've got, 395 that comes in up through the south end of Smithsonian Institution. So, you know, there's a couple ways to still get across, to still stay on the Virginia side, to still stay lawful and legal. Everybody get on the same page and maybe head out. We should probably talk to the administrators of American Spring and see what their plans are, because I'm sure they have their own, you know, paths and ideas and what they want to do. We do expect them actually on this call. One of the administrators for that group's been on here a couple times and has promised to get Vallely and a couple other of the bigger leaders that are involved in that onto this call in the near future. So we look forward to having that happen.
Brian?
Yeah, please post that.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, Brian, I have a question.
I'm first.
Brian, go ahead. It's okay.
Do you know the people that are running this?
Can I say I know personally? Negative. But again, do I know them? Know them? No. But the administrators have called in on this call a couple times.
Okay. I have two words for you to give to them. Porta potties. It might sound funny, but let
me tell
you. That's
what a tree is for, damn it.
In D.C.
You know what? I'm not laughing at you. I'm laughing with you. That was that's a very intelligent thing to say, believe it or not.
Trees and bushes.
I would rather squat in front of a rock than sit in a porta potty.
Yeah, a lot of people wouldn't think of it, I can tell you that.
Yeah, well, September 11th, we climbed up onto the back of a truck that was in traffic on Constitutional Avenue and used the porta potty that was tied down on top of the truck.
There you go. There you go.
And I believe I still have pictures of it.
No, I don't want to see that.
Wow. All
right. But it's just something to think about. If you're planning on spending any amount of time there, there are no public bathrooms.
Well, I just ain't gonna worry about that out there in the desert, though. Yeah.
No, you can just cop a squat behind a bush.
For real.
Exactly. Bring some toilet paper.
In D.C., there's cameras everywhere. You don't cop a squat in D.C. because they're going to see everything you're squatting with.
Yeah, you live in a true freedom place out there.
Hey, Reed may like it.
Hey,
hey,
that's my dad.
Brian.
Yeah, I'm still here.
Did you ever hear about what's going on in Germany where the citizenry is destroying cameras?
I have heard about that, that the public's been doing that.
Smart people.
Yeah,
that happening over here?
I can't speak out about that. Not like I would be mad if that happened. Shit, I've considered doing that myself out here, but... again, I'm in Chicago.
I'm just saying, because like, we're surveilled probably worse than them, you know, and we're sitting here where the, you know what I mean?
Well, acting like it's no big deal, getting used to it, let it sink in as they turn up the fire on this pot of boiling frogs.
Well, the government can take a satellite and look down on you. I mean, Google Earth, they take Google Earth to a whole nother level, you know.
You see, what the Germans are doing, see, the thing is between Germany and us is that their water isn't fluoridated.
Well,
that's
true.
Why they're not scared.
If you look on my Facebook, I have approximately 15 relatives in Germany right now who born and raised in Germany, never left. My real mother's there, my grandmother, grandfather, aunts, uncles, cousins, and they're on my Facebook. We talk every day. There has been in Cape Town and Frankfurt, there was a few incidents happening with them tearing down the cameras. What they did was they arrested three people, and then a group of 75 showed up and demonstrated, and as the group going on for 2 days, the group grew to about 150 to 200 people, my cousin said, and after that they released the people they arrested, and the cameras were not put back up. So they haven't taken down any cameras because they contacted me because they noticed that it was happening here in Florida because I was posting it on my Facebook about Florida putting them up and taking them down here in Orange County. Actually, Orange County's taking them all down now. We're in the process of taking them all down because of the outrage, but... I talk to them on a daily basis, some of them, most of them, and they say that's not like a big widespread issue right now. It's just happening in a few small towns and Frankfurt, which being the biggest.
Well, what I'm saying is that this whole thing that America doesn't go through, I mean, what's the next, I mean, just throwing out there, maybe this is something can do, or I don't know.
Well, America is, I mean, there are a lot of states that are fighting this now. I know Florida, certain counties in Florida, Kissimmee, Osceola County, Orange County is fighting it to take them down. There have been a few taken down. They're leaving them up at major intersections. Their whole reasoning for this, yes.
What you got to do is start a movement. Start it nationwide. Get hold of one friend in each state. Start a movement. Every camera you see, spray paint the sucker. Rip it. Well, if you rip it down, it's destruction of private property.
Even if you spray paint it, it's destruction, though. Even if you spray paint it, get near it and touch it, it's a felony. They charge you a felony in the state of Florida.
That's why when you go there, you know, if you were to do this, let's say in a parallel universe, you would take off your plates, you wear something to cover your head so they can't see you, and you do it quickly.
Yeah,
in a parallel universe. I mean, I would never do this personally.
If you guys know Florida, you know those lights are always overhanging.
You can't even get to them. You can't even get to them. They're so high up there, they're hanging right by the street light.
And it's impossible to basically do this. Once the red light comes in either direction, I'm sorry?
I don't know. There's got to be something that can hit it.
Well, catapult. I mean, yeah, you could definitely take them out, but then you got, you know, how are you going to do that with a firearm, which is, you know, unlawful anyway to discharge the firearm in city public or county even down here where I'm at. So you'd be facing felony charges either way. There's probably
a high-frequency laser?
Well, what they were talking about is I was thinking EMPs. You can build a small EMP. It was shut down.
Sir, you are now unmuted, but now I am remuting you. You cannot say what you are about to say on this conference call. Please cease and desist. The instructions you were about to give us, my friend. I appreciate that, but this is an open forum that has been monitored most likely. So please, for the love of God, do not carry any further with the sentence that was just coming out of your mouth. I appreciate your input. I really do. But that type of information needs to be withheld from this conversation.
I got you. I understand.
That was cool. Brian, you hit hold, I hit mute.
Right at the same time. But zip. Ixnay on the Upstream Stray for EMP Ray Ike Stray. Okay,
yeah. You ain't got to break it down. I'm good.
Yeah, dude, because we actually said a little too much earlier when we had Blaine on the phone about certain eyes in the sky, stuff like that, and you know, we can only leak little pieces, dude. We can only leak little pieces. Based on what you said, we got a lot of good researchers out there that could look that kind of stuff up. You know, think for themselves for what's kind of obvious. But yeah.
Yeah, I got you. I understand.
I totally agree with what you were just saying, and I love the idea behind it. And someday that actually might have to happen. So therefore, based on what was just said, we kind of got to watch it. You know what I mean?
I understand. No problem.
Larry Murdoch.
Hey, Brian, I have a question for you.
Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to know if you ever got in touch with that Karen lady from the Operation American Spring, or if you can have her on the conference call, or have you not been able to get in touch with her? Or?
I have been, and coincidentally, I have had conversations with her as early as earlier today, and
really, was she going to come on our show and talk?
Well, she actually wanted to kind of come in today, but let me actually pull up the messages because
can you get her like
while you pull that up? While you pull that up, please let me correct this. This is not a show. This is not a radio show. This is a conference call.
It's late.
No. I know you think I know what you mean, but we cannot call it a show. We have to call it a conference call.
Oh, that's fine. Yeah.
I called it the chat line today.
No!
What all did she say when you asked her about that? Did she really resign in the way that she resigned, or how did she explain it?
Yeah, I'm trying to find. All right. Well, here's one message from, I'm just going to say, Brandy.
Okay.
And they said that they were going to come in. They said that they had tried, but they didn't figure out the number situation. Colonel Riley has liberalism. Let's see here. How can I abbreviate this conversation? Basically, I'm just going to read it then. He tried several times, but it wouldn't work for him. Maybe it was on his end, but because she got in fine, she was listening. He is also exhausted from 27 straight hours of driving after they delivered the articles of impeachment to the 22nd. He drove 27 hours there, then we delivered them, and then walked 12 straight hours, showing first-timers around D.C., and then he drove 27 hours straight back to Oklahoma. Colonel Harry Riley had us deliver them with his organization, Operation American Spring. The person that I've been talking to lives 2 hours from D.C., and they're all just kind of wiped out, but yeah, they're definitely making plans on getting a hold of us in the near future. I've got some other data here that I have to get back to somebody by Monday night. So.
Did she say why she resigned, or did you get a chance to ask her about that?
I'm going to save that speech for later. It's an important conversation to have. So if we have her on the line sometime next week, I'll definitely blast it and put it out there. I'm going to try to save it for next Friday if I can. That seems to be a hot time to have these calls because people are home and whatnot.
I hope so. She sounds like she's so intelligent. I'd really love to get her gist on what's going on and why she felt she had to resign from such a big, important, go-between post that could go national or international, you know?
Oh, I think it just went from, all right, great, they want to do this, and it's a great idea and everything behind it, but then when she realized that there's quite a huge chance for violence as well as, this being the straw that broke the camel's back, considering she doesn't want to be responsible for that. I wouldn't want to be responsible for that.
No, you're right.
I got to admit, this phone call is kind of breaking some of those barriers as well, and I don't want to really be responsible. I can throw out ideas and such, but she's the one giving directions. I'm the one throwing out friendly advice. She's the one organizing them. I know guys are headed out there, and I could recommend to go to Bundy Ranch peacefully, but there are people definitely headed to D.C. with guns, and she doesn't like that idea very much, and there's not much she can do to thwart them from doing so. Neither can I, neither can Barbie or anybody else here. People are going to do what they want to do, and there was plenty of shitheads that headed towards the Bundy Ranch, so I can just imagine how many of them, are considering heading towards D.C. There's going to be a ton of good people, don't get me wrong, but it's one bad apple, and one Molotov or one freaking gunshot or whatever, and that gives them open season on Patriots.
Yeah. Well, I'm proud of her for resigning if she felt she had to. That way it just washes her hands from any liability or whatever.
Pretty much. I mean, put yourself in her shoes for a minute.
Organize such a big thing, and to that be your baby, sort of like she was going to put it together. She was going to, try to talk to the media and this and that. For her to feel like she had to go that extreme step to resign, I mean, I'm sure it just broke her heart, because that was one thing that she was proud of.
Well, I can only imagine. If something like that forced our hand here, to a point where some caller on our conversation decided to go ape shits in D.C. and it was our fault. I don't want to be that guy either. And, she doesn't want to be that one. As of right now, we're not organizing really the situation. If anything, we're trying to deter a crappy situation. So we'd like to at least talk to the administrators, understand exactly what they want and how they want it. Do they have a game plan? If they don't have a game plan, I don't like this idea very much, and I wouldn't support it, to be honest.
Yeah. Well, hopefully you'll get her next Friday.
Well, I hope so, because a lot of people have said, hey, dude, I know you want to have this conference call about this, but, be very careful. All I know is it's going to happen with or without us, so whatever we can do to dissuade a violent reaction and push for a peaceful solution as hopefully what we achieved thus far with the Bundy Ranch, then great. But, it could go one way, and we don't know how it's going to happen. But there's a lot
of... You can really shed some light on the D.C. thing, though, if you can get an interview with her. I think that in and of itself would be great.
Definitely working on it. I'd like her and any of the other administrators involved in that. And
What about Harry Riley? Can you get him, or is that just like a no, not going to happen?
Larry Murdoch.
Yes, yes.
Thank you for all your help tonight. I really did appreciate it. I didn't want you to leave without me publicly saying it in front of everybody. Thank you for your help.
Absolutely. Oh,
sweet.
There's one more note on the OAS. Last year when we did the march on D.C., there were feds that were posing as patriots saying that Camp Freedom in Maryland is safe. Go ahead, you know, we're staging here. It's okay to bring your weapons in, blah, blah, blah. And SWAT team was waiting for them. So let's make sure no matter what happens, that mistake doesn't happen again this year.
Okay.
Maryland is not a safe place. Camp Freedom is not safe. If you do have weapons or whatever, they have to stay in Virginia.
Yeah, I agree. Larry, thank you.
Very
sweet
welcome.
Dreams.
Good night. Good night, everybody. I gotta go to bed.
Yeah, same here.
Yes, the background noise is done. Brian, thank you for all your help tonight, and hopefully tomorrow night will be tons better.
Hey, Brian, real quick before y'all hang up. This is Sarah again in Alabama. I got a question real quick. They're still blasting that crap about the drones, and I know earlier y'all had spoke with him, but I had some things going on at the house and couldn't listen like I wanted to. Was all that just crap, or what about that drone attack?
Total crap.
Total crap.
I figured it was. I just wanted, because they're saying it come off an Oath Keepers page, and they keep it going because of that.
It was on the Oath Keepers site. It has been taken down.
Awesome. Awesome. All right. And by the way, Brian, you never missed a beat on telling people to go not hot-headed. I think that several people were gung-ho when they got in their cars and ready to go to the Bundy Ranch, and they called you for direction, and I know for a fact you probably calmed several of them down. If anything did happen, it wouldn't be on your hands. Y'all have done everything in your power to make sure people were calm, collected, doing the right thing peacefully, and I just hope that if you're not giving the people in D.C. direction on, you know, where to go or what to do, that somebody like y'all is. Because you've never missed a beat, never. And the girl on here, Barbie, you seem to be just as awesome, Seth.
Thank
you. I just hope they have the same kind of guidance as the people here do. So, y'all, good night, y'all, and I appreciate that.
Good night. We hope you come back again.
I will. Bye-bye, y'all.
Hey, Barb.
Yes.
Since we're late into the night, and I know, you know, you can be an insomniac at times, but
no.
I'm willing to let you take a little break. I've got that one MP3 that a lot of people wanted to hear uploaded right now.
Take a vote first.
It's the longer one. It's the railroad one. It's like literally an hour and 50 minutes. I could put it on loop
those,
so you get at least.
Those people aren't here.
You get it. Well, anybody to hear it. It's very interesting information. It's very pertinent to what actually happened with the Bundy Ranch. And it's very eye-opening and eye-awakening. I know everybody likes talking and whatnot, but, you know.
It's very eye-closing.
What's that?
It made me tired.
Hey, some people, you know, it's just a recording of another conference call, although that conference call had very, very important information that it's very important that people learn and know. If it makes them go away or it makes them fall asleep, you know, so be it. You know, it's past midnight, 2 in the morning, there's not too much to really say as far as the Bundy Ranch. You know, they had their time. I don't mind blasting for 2 hours so people can take a break or do whatever they got to do. If they want to hear it, great, they should. But if they don't, at least it's important and pertinent information.
I could
call Kelso and tell him to take the next 3 hours.
No, he already went offline. He gave me a nice long speech first.
Oh, good.
Yeah, thanks.
Feel free to copy-paste me that, if you don't mind.
No. Tango 800, are you still here? Tango. Hey, Tango.
No tengo.
Well, I swore he said he wanted to talk to you.
I don't know. I don't hear him.
Can I just take a picture of all of it for you? It's like three pictures long. I don't want to type all this back to you.
Does it copy paste?
No, because it was one sentence. Bing, 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 bing.
You can copy that, and you can paste it.
I put a picture, and it'll go in three instead of 15.
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead.
One, two, three.
Oh, dear.
I'll be back.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, everybody, it is now 2:26 a.m. Central Standard Time. Thank you for calling into the community conference call. You are on an open, unmoderated, with two moderators present, conference call. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, please feel free to speak up at any time. We're here to answer your questions, address your comments, and listen to your concerns. This is Barbie.
Michigan One here.
Hey, Michigan One.
I thought, no, I was back up out here. I just had to do some tracing, try to find out what I could on that one post. And I did put a blast out there on Facebook saying, hey, do you see some? Here's the number. Here's the code. Come in. Ask us. Don't repost without asking us if it's actual facts. We've got to eliminate a lot of this disinformation that's out there.
Yes, sir.
We've been trying, man. We've been trying. Trust us. I know. It's like, as soon as you guys give me that name of the person that originated it, like I said, I have direct contact with the founder of Frontiersman. I can get that squashed real quick.
Excellent.
And if you want to make contact with the founder, he goes by the Facebook name Ohio Frontiersman.
Was it somebody in his organization that posted it, like they said?
That's what I got the impression of. Somebody from the Frontiersman organization was the origination of that post. Just haven't got the identity yet.
Oh. Well, it's pulled down now. It's all good.
Yeah, but I know that my statement's getting routed around to the Frontiersman because one of the guys I know that's in there reposted what I said, and then I had Oathkeeper come in and repost it also. So we're going to get out there slowly but surely that more people come in here and verify. That way we can get this disinformation taken care of. Best because it's impossible to eliminate, but we can do our best to get rid of it.
Yeah, and see, Brian, if you put that on the loop, then I'm going to go lay down in bed. I can go lay down in bed without watching the board. I can take everything with me and lay down, and I don't have to listen to music, and people come in and want this verified. I can verify it. They'll be happy. Am I winning this fight at all? He's not listening to me.
It's 2:30 in the morning. I don't think people are panicking that much right now at 2:30 in the morning.
Oh, yes, they are. Go check your Facebook page. Quick, somebody go post something. No, there are people in here until 6 o'clock in the morning asking questions.
Why? Go to bed.
Because people want to know.
Yep.
But they were here. They heard it. There's nothing.
Some people actually work different hours. so that's the only time they can be on.
Yeah, look at November 2-8 there. November 2-8, what time did you get off work today? No, don't answer that. You had off today. What time did you get off work yesterday?
11 o'clock my time.
Which is?
Well, right now it's 12:30 where I'm at.
So that would be Pacific time. Correct?
I don't know. We had this conversation yesterday. I don't know about this time clock change stuff because we never do it.
And how long are you going to hang out in here with me November 2-8?
I actually got to get going to bed here soon because I got an early day tomorrow.
Okay, Brian, you win.
Yeah, I mean, there's a dozen some odd people in here. Hey, if you guys don't mind, this is an MP3 I recorded of a conversation of some friends. It's huge. I think it's very important information. I can't even explain to you how important I think it is. I wish I could just spill out all the facts that he drops during this conversation. If it gets boring, hey, I apologize. It's only an hour and 50 minutes maybe. So it'll be long enough to give everybody a big rest if you don't want to hear it. But then Barbie will be right back, I'm sure, within milliseconds of this MP3 stopping playing. just to shut it off and restart this conversation so all you non-sleeping people can keep conversing. And actually that'll be just in time for whatever the freaky stuff that happens after 4 o'clock that I'm still not aware of.
So you're not leaving, are you?
I've got to fall asleep soon. Let me just say this without being too obnoxious. David Kelso, Chicago One, great guy that's been chiming in a lot. I'm going to be meeting up with him tomorrow at around noon. And I'm going to have a long conversation with this guy and get things straightened out to see what he can and cannot add to these conversations.
Hey, Brian.
Yes, ma'am?
I have got to say it. If he blows you off, I'm going to laugh at you.
Nice choice of words.
I'm trying to eat.
I didn't even think of it that way. You know what I meant.
My wife has her suspicions, let me tell you. I'm just going to leave it at that. The guy seems really nice. I'm bringing backup, though, okay? So it's cool. But just in case I don't come back, avenge my death. No, he seems like a cool enough guy. He's just different, and he's obviously trying to add some technical capability to what we're doing here. If he's got some good advice, I'll take it. There's just some boundaries that definitely need to be set so he kind of knows where we're trying to go and not go. I really respect what he's added this far, but, you know, sometimes people have a way of going a little overboard on some things, and I just want to kind of curb that. Again, I appreciate what he's done and been doing, but, you know, and I understand it. I've invested time and effort into things that I had no part of, and then after you've invested so much time and effort into it, you start feeling like it's partly yours too, you know, and I see where he's coming from, but again, he volunteered that stuff, you know, so.
When do I get that talk? I want that talk too.
Yeah, but I'm not telling you to tone it down. You're just fine.
You just keep believing that.
Well, then again, I don't know what's happening between 4 and 6, but it is what it is. But I'm going to go ahead and play this MP3. Give it an hour. If you don't like it, Barbie, go ahead. But it is very informative stuff. This is stuff like you kind of want to break out of. Actually, if you guys listen to this, I highly recommend if you have it, grab a pen and paper because the stuff you're about to hear is pretty freaking important. You'll be like, holy shit, that's how it started, that's how it happened, and that's how they're running the show. I find it really important.
Good night, Brian.
Yes. Love you, Barb. Love you guys. Thanks, everybody, for hanging out tonight. Sorry we didn't get actually Cliven on the phone. That was not expected. I had some people that had confirmed
see
that.
See you there tomorrow.
Couldn't make it happen. Until further notice, man, I kind of feel like a schmutz about it, but at least it went well. At least we had Blaine on the phone for long enough. You know, that's the rancher's bodyguard. That's about as high up as we have gotten so far outside of when I talked to Blaine. Or, I'm sorry, when I talked to their daughter.
No, we had Buddha twice.
Oh, yeah, Buddha was on before, too. That's right. But, Bailey is the name I mentioned. I did talk to Bailey for a second in the past, but that was when her daughter was sick. So, anyways, I'm going to go ahead and press play. If you guys want to listen, I highly recommend you grab a pen. Other than that, I'm going to crash out. Most likely, Barbie will be back here in about an hour and a half.
Okie dokie. Did you want to do an intro?
Well,
yourself. I'll just give you a little story here that I came up with. It's going to be easier for people to understand from a different point of view because it's going to be the first time hearing this in their entire lives. When you're on imagine yourself, okay, imagine you owning a railroad car and a steam engine, okay, and the very first thing you got to do is put tracks on the ground. In order to put tracks on the ground, you have to acquire property. In order to acquire property, you have to go out and keep buying and putting, easements through everybody else's land. Well, way back in the day, it used to be a lot of public land. So that means you're going to have to be working with the government all the time. Okay? It's much easier if you work with the government that you created yourself. Much easier. Now, there's certain things that your train is going to need. It's going to need water for the steam. It's going to need wood or coal. And it's going to need some kind of service station, okay, so that you can stop. Then you're going to need places to deliver the goods. So if you're going to be bringing goods and developing from east to west, let's go back into the early 1800s, you got to think about that way. If you go back to that time, you have to bring things that are being produced from the east all the way out to the west. You have to watch it because especially in products and things like that, you have to make sure that the products that you're giving out you're not producing too many. Because if you're producing too many, then the price of your product goes down. So you absolutely have to expand. So what's the best way to do that back then would be the railroad. So you go, say your railroad track is going across the country. Now you're going to have stops, okay? And that's what they call development, setting up cities. And cities were always built by railroad tracks. There is no accident there, guys. None whatsoever. It always was done that way. So if you needed, say you went from A to B, and between A and B, you needed a way to stop, okay, you could get that far to that. In other words, B was far enough away from A that you could make it there, and your train didn't need water. It didn't need coal or wood or anything like that, so that's fine. So you've got from A to B there. By the time you get to B, B has to have water, it has to have coal, it has to have wood in order to replenish the train so it can get to C. Now, you don't want to be leaving your water, your coal, and your wood out in the middle of nowhere without being secured to make sure that you know that delivery and that guarantee is going to get there. So what do? You start building a city, okay, where it will start bringing people out there. So on that same train, you start saying the Great West, Great Frontier. You start promoting it. You start advertising it. People want to go out west. Now, when they get out there, it's nothing like they were told, but it's too late by that time. So they're basically stuck. So in order to make it what they thought it was and what that dream was, they start building that town and developing that town that just happens to be owned by the railroad. Now, those people, now what do you do? If you're if you own the railroad, you'll walk up to the to a man that you think that has enough gumption to protect that town, and you give him a little badge and call him a sheriff. And you say, this is what I want you to do. I don't care what you do in this town. We just want you to keep the peace, but make sure that my trains have water, coal, and wood. That's all I care about. As long as this depot is secure and you are protecting it from the people that are in that town, then that's all I care about. Okay? Now, what do you do? Now, the railroad owns the town, but the railroad doesn't want the bill to have the upkeep of that town or to pay those people to keep that town or keep it safe or to protect it or anything else. So what do? You make citizens out of them. And then you start taxes. That made it completely free and clear that that train depot and that train station is perfectly secure. It costs nothing to maintain, and you're actually making money with it. Zero to maintain. That's the thinking behind the railroad. Now, let's bring it up to today. Now, all the banks that you see today are owned by the railroad companies, including the Federal Reserve. Every bank in existence, because the banks started on the railroad, and they started on the railroad engines. That's why trains used to be robbed all the time. And that's what they were doing. What they were doing is they created a U.S. Treasury, the railroads did. They created a U.S. Treasury, and they said that they can only mint coin mint coin. So what better way to mint the coin? It's your coin because you have all the mineral rights to the coin. Then you put it on your train that just happens to be a bank also, and then you distribute it throughout the country in towns that are yours that cost you absolutely nothing to maintain. You're making not only millions, you're making billions, and include passengers on that train. You can also on that train create a class system, first, second, third class, which would go out into, like begets like, cities. You have first, second, and third class citizens. Everything started on the trains. Everything started with the railroads. Even today, the railroads own all the cities. They own all the property. They have claimed all the mineral rights and all the deeds from 15 miles out each side of the tracks through all counties. And train tracks go through every county in this country. There are 9 families that own these trains, these train stations, and these train companies. Okay? Now, Washington, D.C. used to be called the Virginia Company. Okay, the earlier formed company, the name of the Virginia Company, was in need of some revamping, and it was time for a name change and some reorganization for the company. Owned by the King of England, it still is. He says it's owned by the King of England, but actually it's the 9 Baron families. Another effort to hide ownership and give the people a false hope for freedom in the outside controlling monarch in this country. The United States of America was for some time being owned by the Crown of England, and the Declaration of Independence did not let us, the common people, free from the outright ownership of this country by the original 48 controlling families of Europe. The Virginia Company was renamed the United States of America, a corporation. So that one, the United States of America, all lowercase the, was owned by the Virginia Company. That was a railroad. And it still is today. So when you're trying to get a republic into the United States of America and the 1789 Constitution and all this other horse crap, that is called the Virginia Company. It's a southern-based corporation. The owners remain the same, just changed the name. So soon after the new incorporation of the company of the United States of America is a proposal for federal town for the deliberation of the Continental Congress were made in 1789. Okay, that was its origin. It started bringing in Alexander Hamilton, then it started bringing in the capital as far as being near the Potomac, and then President Washington close to the site in October 1790 and persuaded the landowners to sell their holdings to the new government at about $66 an acre. Okay, these areas of land that Washington chose were about 30 square miles of land west of the Potomac. The city's present territory had belonged to Maryland, and the land of the west of the river was part of Virginia. And the two states turned over the territory to the federal government, to a corporation and a body politic. So you want to know the origins of the original 1789? It's called the Virginia Company. It's a railroad company. All right. Now you'll have to be a little patient with me, because there's a lot of pages in this book, and there's 600 of them. I would suggest that everybody get a copy of it, if they can, as soon as possible. Because it talks about the origins of basically everything that you've ever seen in your entire life. It talks about the Federal Reserve, okay? And then there's a Federal Reserve story about that. And if I can find it here, I will. I have all, in this book, they have all of the trust documents for everything that is owned. Who owns what, when, and where. There was a man by the name of L.C. Pacier, okay? He was born in 1850. He owned most of America. Okay, it's Louis Cass Pacier. He was 1850 to 1939. And he says, for a moment, let us digress back to the time when the former Crown Prince of France, known as Daniel Pacier, arrived in America. Daniel married a woman by the name of Suzanne Kaiser, K-I-S-E-R, around the year of 1814. All marriages of this family's bloodline are through all issue of the families to this date. As they say, we keep the marriage in the family. I think that is why they're all strange, if you get my drift. Susanna was the sister of Sarah Kaiser, which married a German by the name of John Reed, who owned the Reed gold mine and started the gold rush fever in the Carolinas. The Pacers were also involved with the gold mines. In Daniel's business, years before his death, he was instrumental in acquiring, with his wealth from the gold holdings, vast holdings in numerous banks, railroad construction companies, railway companies and canal companies, tramway companies, companies in manufacturing railroad engines, railway cars, railway sleeping cars, steam tractors and plows now known as the International Harvester, Colt firearms, Gatlin gun, wagons and buggies, now known as Cadillac cars, okay, so wagons and buggies are where Cadillacs came from, believe it or not. He owned a huge plantation of cotton, tobacco, timber, and corn. He also owned the manufacture of cotton, Eli Whitney, and of cotton gin. Okay, this guy right here was your biggest pain in the butt. Susanna and Daniel had two sons, and firstborn was Adam and then Jonas. At the same time, Adam's young adult life, he was murdered, and all the family's assets were set up to pass to Jonah W. Pacier upon his father Daniel's death. Jonas carried on the family tradition and increased the family holdings to include steamship companies known as United Fruit Company, Mining Equipment Company, Aluminum Company of America, mining companies for coal, iron, copper, gold, and silver, and it was a main supplier to the government for gold and silver. He says, hear that? He was the main supplier for gold and silver to government. If Washington, D.C. was from the Virginia Company, okay? Think about it, guys. If it was from the Virginia Company, that company was turned into a government. What they did was they created a government to protect their assets. That's all they were doing. And you guys and everybody else became unknowing citizens of this particular government to protect their assets. They're there to protect the railroad. That's it. Nothing else. Okay? They started out with meat processing company, now known as Armour, and Company and started with the cattle and stockyards across America at the railroad yards. While the Pacers were busy buying property during the Civil War, the Union government was actively seizing all property and public records. Okay, the reason for this search and seizure was to find out who owned what property so it, the government, could seize more property. What we figured out, what I was reading later on, is a lot of these men that were connected into this family, a lot of these men were a part of the Confederate Army. And what they did was they created a rebellion. They're the ones that started the Confederate states, the Southern Confederate states, and the breakoff to get away from the original Articles of Confederation and the original Federal Union. And what they did was, is as they were doing it, and as all was done, okay, after the Civil War was over and everything else, they ended up buying all the Confederate States railroads for $480 at auction. That's all they wanted in the first place. That's the reason why they started the whole Civil War, and that's the reason why the Civil War ended. When it ended, they went to auction and bought all the railroad cars. That was the only reason for the Civil War. Because I'm going to tell you, it had nothing to do with Lincoln. Okay? Because Lincoln isn't who you think he is. He was nothing like you thought he was. At least I didn't think so. Let me see if I can go back here. I'll see if I can find it. It'll tell you exactly who Lincoln is and who his family was. Okay? I'm going to go to the true Federal Reserve story here in just a few minutes. There are some things in there that weren't talked about. That was 419. Okay, it's got to be between 408 and 419. There he is. Okay. This is, as a researcher of old legal documents for many years, one day while combing through all the old property records and wills in the small courthouse in central North Carolina, I stumbled on the prize of the century. In one of the old will books dated around 1840, I found the will of one A.A. Springs. Okay? They used to be known as Springsteen, who I had misled into believing was the father of one Leroy Springs. He was at the time the person on whom the research was focused. Now, I'm going to stop right there just for a second just to let people know. All this research can be found in public records. They don't hide a thing, but not a lot of people go around in the public records. Everything in this book is in the public record, so just to let you know. Now, upon reading this will, I was shocked and amazed at the secret that it disclosed, but you have to remember that it is a known fact that wills, even though they are classified public records, the same as property and corporation deeds, are rarely combed through and that I have been doing, okay? The practice of hiding secrets in public view can be assessed by anyone because you are the public. It is a double edge to it. It says because when things go as far as ownership of land, they can always say, well, it was there in the public records in plain view for anyone and all to find. Now, this is hilarious. This is the young Leroy Spring, a cousin of Abe's. Look at the resemblance, okay? This is young Leroy Spring, a cousin of Abe's. Look at the resemblance, and he's right. There is a huge resemblance, okay? It says, in the will of A.A. Springs was a list of his property. It went into detail to whom the property was to be dispersed and is included in, and it included his children. I was looking in the records to find out what railroads and banks this man might have owned and had left to his son, Leroy Springs, but Leroy Springs was not his son. I didn't find anything like that, but we did find the prize of the century. On the bottom of the page, page three of four pages, was a paragraph where the father left to his son an enormous amount of land in the state of Alabama, which amounted to the land that is today known as Redstone Arsenal in Huntsville, Alabama. And then he went into detail in the name of the son, and at first I couldn't believe what I was seeing, but there it was, the name one, Abraham Lincoln. How could it be possible? Was this a mistake? No, it wasn't. His son was Abraham Lincoln. Okay? With the information that we had already had about the Springsteen family, this was just another twist to add with this already manipulative family. refer to the chapter in the Springs. Okay, so you have to go to the Springs family to figure that out. So this is new information about Lincoln built a fire under me, and it was led to take me. I'm gonna skip forward because there's a story behind this. In the late spring of the year 1808, Nancy Hanks, who was the family lineage of McAdden family, was visiting some of her family in the community of Lincolnton, North Carolina. While on her stay with the family in the Carolinas, she visited with many of the neighboring families she had known for many years. One such visit was A.A. Springs' family. The sordid details had been omitted, but obviously the young Nancy Hanks had found herself in a compromised or comprised position and was forced to succumb to the lust of A.A. Springs. She became pregnant as a result. There were no details of a love affair or an act of violence on the helpless female. Abraham Lincoln was a result of that act, which leads one to wonder if the name of Lincoln was the real or the fabricated name of the area of conception, Lincolnton. Was there really a Thomas Lincoln? Since the Springs were of the race that called themselves Jews, that made Lincoln part Jewish and part of the Springs family. He also became a relative of the Rothschild family by blood. Now, this guy was unbelievable. Lincoln, unbelievable what he did, okay? Lincoln was a dictator who destroyed the Republic and replaced the federal principles of 1789 with the ideological foundations of today's welfare, warfare state. His administration was characterized by paranoia, a lust for power, and rampant corruption. The magnitude of that paranoia was evidenced by Lincoln's Secretary of War, Edwin M. Stanton, who declared that every department of the government was paralyzed by treason. Traitors were to be found in the Senate, the House of Representatives, and the Cabinet, and the federal courts. Treason was flagrant in the revenue and in the post office service, as well as the territorial governments and in the judicial reserves. In his bid for absolute power, Lincoln used treason as a pretext to unleash war and shred the Constitution. Freedom of the press was curtailed. Chicago Times was one of the over 300 northern newspapers suppressed for expressing incorrect views. As late as May 18, 1864, Lincoln ordered his military to arrest and imprison the editors, proprietors, and publishers of the New York World and New York Journal of Commerce. Lincoln suspended habeas corpus. He criminalized speech and legalized arbitrary arrest. 20,000 political prisoners were held incommunicado and denied legal counsel. Maryland's legislature was overthrown. The New York City was placed under military occupation. In his December 1861 lectures in Boston and New York City, Northern abolitionist Wendell Phillips declared that we live today, every one of us, under martial law. The Secretary of State puts in his Bastille with a warrant as irresponsible as that of Louis XIV, any man whom he pleases. Lincoln's war against the South was not to preserve the Union from treasonous secessionists. Lincoln himself had championed the right of secession. In the speech before Congress on the Mexican-American War, he declared that any people anywhere being inclined and having the power have the right to rise up and shake off an existing government and form a new one that suits them better. Nor did Lincoln wage war against the South to emancipate black slaves. In the first inaugural address on March 4, 1861, Lincoln emphatically declared, "I have no purpose, directly or indirectly, to interfere with the institution of slavery in the states where it exists. I believe I have no lawful right to do so and have no inclination to do so." On September 11, 1861, Lincoln countermanded General Fremont's order freeing the slaves in Missouri, and on May 19, 1862, he countermanded General Hunter's order emancipating the slaves in Georgia, Florida, and South Carolina. On August 22, 1862, Lincoln wrote Horace Greeley declaring, "If I could save the Union without freeing any slave, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing all the slaves, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing some of them, leaving others alone, I would do that also." With the demise of the Confederacy now nowhere in sight, however, Lincoln changed his position on emancipation. On September 13, 1862, Lincoln explained to the visiting delegation of the clergy in the purpose of his forthcoming Emancipation Proclamation, "I view this matter as a practical war measure to be decided on according to the advantages or disadvantages it may offer to the suppression of the rebellion." That the Emancipation Proclamation was a practical war measure can be seen in the fact that it did not free a single slave within the jurisdiction of the Union. The proclamation only declared that all persons held as slaves within any state or designated part of the state, a people whereof, shall then be a rebellion against the United States, and shall then shall be then thenceforth and forever free. Slavery remained legally protected, and those slave states that stayed loyal to the Union, Delaware,